Okay, welcome to today's lecture. Today in the lecture, what I'd like to go over is a number of different aspects of technology that are important for understanding the interaction between technology and society in the context of global disruption. And so one of the things you'll see that both Bill, Bonnie, and myself talk a lot about is we like to put some definitions out there, and that's really important because people in this class are coming from all kinds of different disciplines. And it's pretty important that we understand the language that we're using and what is included and what's not included and the different concepts that we use. Because if we're not speaking the same language, it's going to be hard to effectively solve some of these difficult problems and to engage with some of these predicaments that we find ourselves in. So let's start by just looking at the word technology. Global disruption and information technology, and IT is the name of the class. And technology has some of the same roots as some of the other words we've been looking at in this class. It's a Greek word, and it's made up of two sort of smaller components. The first one being logia, or the study of, and the second one, or the first part, but the second part I'm going to address is techno, which originally had the idea of art or craft or skill. So together, technology has its roots in the history of the development of the word as the study of art or craft or skill. Well, that's not exactly how we think of it today. And as you look at the ways in which it's been used over time, by about 1859, the word technology had taken on more of the framing that we use when we use it, in the sense that we specifically think of it as the study of mechanical or industrial arts, and increasingly information arts or data-driven technologies. And so technology as a word has been changing over time, and about 1859 is when we started seeing it used the way we use it today. Now there's a lot of different ways in which people try and describe technology that are less ways of defining the word for usage and more thought-provoking ways of using the term so that we help to think about, helps us to think about what do we mean when we say technology. So let me give you a few of those. So Alan Kay, who's a computing pioneer, likes to call technology as anything that was invented after you were born. And that's interesting because it draws to the forefront the idea that people like to engage with technology over the course of their lifetime in the sense that they see it progressing and they understand a little bit about its trajectory. And so something that's technology is something that you saw and you grew up with. A science fiction author, Arthur C. Clarke, has more of a literary approach to it. He has a famous quote in which he says that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. This idea draws out the idea that technology is often just a source of wonder for us, and we look to it to solve many of our problems and hope that, like magic, it'll just make it disappear. And so that sort of comes from a literary background. Kind of a more humorous definition is something that's called Krantz-Berg's first law of technology. And that looks at, it's humorous, but it draws out some of the ideas that there are values that are embedded in technology. So the law is as follows: technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. And this idea tries to get us to think about the fact that just because you have a technology doesn't mean that it's necessarily going to be used for something good, just like it's not necessarily going to be used for something bad. But at the same time, different technologies certainly lend themselves to different kinds of uses. Think about a gun as a technology. There's some sort of basic things that you can do with a gun that lend itself to law enforcement and crime. It doesn't really lend itself very well to the same things that a plow might be used for or a satellite might be used for. So it's not explicitly good nor bad, but it's not completely neutral either. When we talk about technology in this class, we're really focusing on information technology. We take a broad view of it, though. So obviously, we have the hardware aspects of information technology. For example, the computer chips that are in laptops and in phones today. We also include the keyboards that we use to type on, the monitors that we use to view things on, the displays that come in our embedded devices, the wires that connect those devices. That's all the hardware, the physical stuff that makes up information technology. There's also a conceptual part of the information technology, which is the software. So these are the apps that you download onto your Android phone. They're the programs that you run on your Mac laptop. It's the computer code, which is written by people and becomes the instructions for how this information technology is used when it's a general purpose computing platform. Now, the reason why we say that this class uses a broader approach to information technology is because we also include some of the infrastructure that's needed in order to make information technology work. So that supporting infrastructure includes things like electricity. Most of our computers can't work unless they're at some point plugged into a wall. There's the cloud now, the sense in which there is computing that is out there far away in data centers. It's not part of the phone that you're carrying or the laptop that you're typing notes on, but it's increasingly critical to doing the things that we expect our computers to do, for websites to run, for banks to operate, for us to be able to order something online. We also think about the wireless spectrum, or the process by which we allocate different frequencies in the atmosphere so that cell phones can communicate, Wi-Fi can operate, televisions can broadcast. These are all part of the infrastructure. And we even go so far as to say that people interacting with technology is part of the infrastructure of information technology. Technologies are largely designed for people, and if they're not designed with people in mind, they're not going to be a very good information technology. So the Information Technology Association of America defines information technology very well in a way that we would largely agree with, as the study, design, development, implementation, support, or management of computer-based information systems, particularly software applications and computer hardware. To that, in our class, we'll include infrastructure and people. So this picture here is kind of is an artist's representation of technology, and it looks a little bit like The Matrix or Minority Report or Iron Man or some kind of advanced user interface that's out there. And we sometimes think about technology as if it's this thing that was just handed down from the sky, like a mountain or like a river, and we forget that at the end of the day, all this complicated technology is made by people. It's made by people who were like you at one point. And I think that Steve Jobs, the one of the visionaries in Apple computers, did a good job in describing it as follows. He says, when you grow up, you tend to get told that the world is the way that it is, and your life is just to live your life inside the world. Try not to bash into the walls too much. Try to have a nice family, have fun, save a little money. That's a very limited life. Life can be much broader once you discover one simple fact. Everything around you that you call life was made up by people that were no smarter than you, and that you can change it, and you can influence it, and you can build your own things that other people can use. Steve Jobs, you know, really lived out this, this quote in a lot of ways, and we want to sort of impress upon you that you can also use technology to change the world, and that's one of the things that we hope that you're going to get out of this.